girls, this is council member Diana Ayala representing East Harlem and the South Bronx. And I'm here today to welcome you to today's Black History Month celebration, where you're gonna be learning a lot about Harriet Tubman, George Washington Carver, Madam C.J. Walker, and Martin Luther King. Have fun and have a beautiful Black History Month.
God is gonna trouble the waters. God is gonna trouble the waters. Hello, children. Mama, look at all these fine faces looking back at me. Let me just get a good look at you. Beautiful. Well, my name is Harriet Tubman, and I was invited here today to tell you a little bit about my life. Now, I'll be joined by other pioneers in African American history, some who came before me and others who came afterwards. Would that be all right? How's that sound? Well, can't nobody tell my story better than me, so I guess the best place for me to start is at the beginning. I was born into slavery in 1820 on a plantation back in Dorchester County, Maryland, to that mean old Edward Brotus. My birth name was Araminta. They used to call me Minty growing up until I changed my name to Harry. My parents were enslaved Ashanti Africans. 11 children. Many of them who they saw sold into slavery. Unfortunately, that was common practice on plantations. Now, when I was a bit younger than you, I was already working. At 5 years old, I was rented to neighbors to do housework. And I was never any good at it, so I got beaten often, regularly, by my owners and by the pimp people who rented me to. Now, of course, I wasn't educated to read or write, so I became a field worker. I preferred that over housework. Now, don't get me wrong, I was small, but I was strong too. Working in the field contributed to my strength. At age 15, I was hit in the head by a heavyweight. It happened when I deliberately blocked the path of an overseer who was in pursuit of a runaway slave. As he was aiming for the slave, he missed. He missed and he, oh! Ooh. Oh, he hit me. I never fully recovered after that. I developed what they call sleeping fits. That made me less attractive to those who wanted my services, as a slave. But as I healed and got better, they put me back to work in the fields. Now, I was chopping wood and carrying sage. I did everything they expected the men to do. I saw people worked to death and beaten to death. Now, when the old slave master died, The son who inherited us slaves, he hired me out to a lumber merchant who appreciated my work. And he let me keep some of the money that I earned from extra work that I did, too. Now in 1844, I married a free black man who lived on a plantation nearby named John Tubman. Yes. I loved him dearly. When I asked him if we could move north so I could be free, he said no. Told me that he didn't think it was a good idea. That he was fearful that I would cause trouble for the both of us. Then he had nerve to tell me to stand in a woman's place. Ooh, that got me so mad I wanted to hit him over the head with a kettle. Now, even though he refused to go, I never gave up my hopes and dreams. See, because I wanted to be free. Yeah. I just stopped telling my husband about all my plans. But I never gave up on my dreams. I remember the day I left like it was yesterday. It was in 1849. I remember I left out without uttering a word to my husband. He didn't know where I was going or if I was even coming back. I ran away with two of my brothers. See, but they turned around, they went back because they were too scared to continue. They wanted me to return with them, but I was too scared to go back. See, I couldn't live not one more day as a slave. No, I just couldn't do it. And I remember waiting till nightfall. I would take the back roads and wade through troubled waters. At first, all I had was the fire in my belly, the passion that I had for freedom, and the North Star as my guide. I soon learned that help would be provided along. Now, children, y'all know what abolitionists are? Those are people who are against slavery. And I had many of them people helping me out along the way. Yeah, abolitionists, they told me everything I needed to know about the Underground Railroad. They hid me during the day, they gave me food and water, and they gave me directions to the next place that would help me out. Yeah. You see, the key to my success was keeping people together. I was able to work with abolitionists on the Underground Railroad, and I was able to meet with slaves in secret. Like I said, don't let my size fool you. I'm only 5 foot tall, but I am strong and I carry a rifle full of buckshot that I ain't afraid to use. Yeah. You see, I would use the rifle to ward off any pro-slavery people who we might encounter. But I also used it. I used it against any slaves who might want to turn back. You see, anybody who will return, they could put a danger to the whole mission. They could spill too many secrets. Who helped us? What paths we took? How messages were passed? No, we couldn't risk it. We couldn't risk it at all. No. No. Still. steal away. Now you decide. I cannot put the rest of us at risk.
Okay, Harry. Okay.
Now go on. Get. Between 1850 and 1860, I made over 19 trips leading runaway slaves to freedom. I went back to get as many people as I could, including my parents, my brothers, and my sister. Without the Underground Railroad, we would have been captured. And I surely would have been killed. You know, those slave masters wanted to catch me so bad, they all got together and put a bounty on my head. Yeah. The bounty was set as high as $40,000 for my capture, dead or alive. But you know what, children? I was never betrayed. Never. No, you cannot put a price on freedom. And when I died in 1913 at the age of 93, I died knowing just that. Cherish the lives you live, children. And remember that many lives were sacrificed, both black and white, for what you call freedom.
Wade in the water, children. Wade in the water. God's gonna trouble water.
Hello, boys and girls. I'm so happy you came by today so I can finally share with you my life story. My name is George Washington Carver. I was born into slavery, 1861, near Diamond Grove, Missouri. My mother was a slave, owned by Moses Carver. When I was a little boy, the country was in the middle of the Civil War. During the war, slave owners had a hard time keeping track of their slaves. So Moses Carver sent all of his slaves to Arkansas, including my mother and I. When the war ended, all of his slaves disappeared, except for me. I was a frail, sick, motherless child, unable to do heavy farm work, but I was lucky. The Carver family took a liking to me and nursed me back to health. When I was better, they would let me play in the yard where I would experiment with plants and flowers. I was about 4 or 5 when slavery ended. And even though I was no longer a slave, the Carver family let me stay on their plantation until I was 10 or 12 years old. When I left, I would wander off in the wilderness where I would continue to develop my interest in plants and flowers. But I didn't always have it easy. As a young man, I was lonely. I had all sorts of hardships and lived in poverty. I had to deal with a lot of prejudice because of the color of my skin. But you think I gave up, boys and girls? No, I scraped and struggled to self-educate myself and did whatever I had to so I could survive. I took a job as a household worker, a hotel cook, a laundryman, a farm laborer and a homesteader. By the time I reached my late 20s, I was able to earn a high school education from a school in Minneapolis, Kansas. After high school, I was accepted to a university in Kansas, but was later rejected when they learned that I was black. Plants were not my only interest. I studied art and piano at Simpson College in Indianola, Iowa. In fact, I am quite the accomplished canvas painter. After Simpson College, I went to Iowa State Agricultural College, where in 1894, I earned a Bachelor of Science in Agricultural Science, and in 1896, a Master of Science. So here I am, at 35 with my degrees and all. Not too bad for a poor slave owner, would you say? But little did I know, my career was just starting. In 1894, I left Iowa for Alabama to direct the new agricultural department at the Tuskegee Industrial Institute, a school headed by the famous black educator Booker T. Washington. Yes, it was at Tuskegee where my passion for finding ways to improve conditions for black Americans began. You see, boys and girls, it was my belief that black Americans could improve their conditions for the better through learning skills and education. I had no interest in using politics to promote change. My life work was devoted to teaching poor sharecroppers in the South on ways to improve their soil so their crops could grow. My education and skills, I was able to help both black and white farmers on how to improve their soil. You see, boys and girls, the Deep South was in deep trouble. The soils in their fields were so damaged that they could not grow anything. I learned that the three best crops for improving one's soil are peanuts, sweet potatoes, and soybeans. From the peanut alone, I invented over 300 products, including cheese, milk, flour, ink, dyes, plastics, wood stain, soap, medicinal oils, and cosmetics. And from the sweet potato, I developed 118 products, including flour, vinegar, molasses, rubber, ink, a synthetic rubber, and postage stamp glue. By 1940, my peanut inventions helped the South to be free of the cotton and allowed the South to no longer depend on the cotton as its major crop. My accomplishments also allowed me to win several awards. Among them were my induction to Britain's Society for the Encouragement of Arts, Manufacturers, and Commerce. My accomplishments also allowed me to keep company with the rich and famous. I had visitors like Presidents Calvin Coolidge and Franklin D. Roosevelt. My friends were the likes of Mahatma Gandhi and Henry Ford. Well, I was offered so many gifts and favors throughout my life, but boys and girls, I was never a man who cared for the luxuries of the world. As I matured, I only cared to help people and do my work that began with my devotion to help poor black sharecroppers in the South. However, I am happy and thankful that my work was able to help the entire South, since farming was such a most important and common job for Americans. Well, after a long and prosperous life, I died January 5th, 1943. Boys and girls, if I may, I would like to leave you with this thought. You see, boys and girls, I wanted to tell you my life story so you could understand that life is not easy and things are not going to be handed to you. Oh yeah, life is tough, but you got to be tougher. Go for your dreams no matter what they are, and never let anyone tell you you can't accomplish your goals, or let anyone call you dumb, because if they do, they're not your friend. Believe in yourself. believe in yourself. Well, in parting, the next time you use a postage stamp or eat a peanut butter sandwich, you can thank me, George Washington Carver. Thank you.
These haunting questions. My heart home to rest in my life. All I have, all my dreams, dreams of my family, dreams of my children. Many nights I lay awake thinking about my family, thinking about my children, and what I would write to my wedding. My wedding. My wedding.
Good morning, boys and girls. My name is Lou Zuckman, and I am one of the original Freedom Riders. This year marks the 59th year of our ride for freedom. The year was 1961, in which black and white Freedom Riders set out towards the South to challenge local segregation laws. What that meant was, blacks and whites were separated during their daily life. We couldn't eat together. We couldn't drink from the same fountain or attend the same schools together. Now, I wasn't much of a political or an intellectual as a young man. I was a 19-year-old white kid from Forest Hills who got into a little bit of trouble. I'd been a juvenile delinquent. Now, I never was scared of violence for whatever reason. But I had no idea what life had in store for me. You see, when I was 2.5, my father committed suicide. My mother died 6 months after I came back. She tried the best she could. I remember when I was 6, reading the autobiography of my idol, Jackie Robinson. And I admired him, not only because he was a great baseball player, but because he had this great temper. I was moved on how he could just set the world aside while he's breaking the color lines. And you know, it took years of him not fighting back. That, to me, took courage. I remember one night, I'm watching the news, and I see that the first Freedom Ride bus was firebombed, and that the second bus going to Montgomery, Alabama was attacked by the KKK. I was watching, you know, this program one day called Open End, where I saw Jackie Robinson, Ray Wilkins, Whitney Young, and Hank Thomas speak so eloquently on how important it is for these rides to continue. I saw my idol, Jackie Robinson, stand up and say, if the young people want to stand up and do what's right, who are we to tell them not to? Right then and there, I was sold. I went down to CORE, the Congress of Racial Equality, and I signed right up. All right, so there were 6 of us on the bus, okay, on a regular bus. And the plan was to get arrested in Jackson, Mississippi, not before. After leaving the Memphis terminal, there were some racial tensions. And that's when I knew that my 1961 journey might be met with mob violence in both Mississippi and Alabama. So we get back on the bus and we start venturing our way to Jackson, Mississippi. And in the, I hear some guys talking and they're looking right at us and they say, I want to get my brother-in-law down there to lynch you. Oh. So we get into Jackson, Mississippi, and the plan goes into effect. I go into the black seating area, and the black Freedom Riders go into the white seating area. We were asked to move, and when we didn't, we were arrested and put in jail. Then we were sent to Parchment State Penitentiary. We didn't even talk to each other on the bus. And we were moved around from place to place in Parchment State that we hardly got to know anyone. The blacks and whites were separated, of course, as were the men and women. That prison system wasn't built for an additional 400 prisoners. So you know where they kept us? On death row. The only time that I personally got to know anyone was at the barracks over at Parchment State, but then we'd just get shuffled right back to death row again. It wasn't all fun. There was times that we fought amongst each other. There was times that I wished that I just stayed home, you know? I was scared. I was confused. But you know, deep down, I knew that the rewards were so much bigger than the struggle. Sitting in jail, I will recollect stories that my grandmother and grandfather, two Eastern European Jewish immigrants, would tell me on how hard it was for the Jewish community when they got here, and how hard it was for black people. All those pieces were powerful pieces for me. You know, when I got out of jail, I stayed with black families. And I gotta tell you, it was a nice experience. Overall, it was profound and transformative. It was the first time in my life that I stood up and I did something positive. It helped change me. I felt like I was doing what I believed in. I am the executive director of the Supportive Children's Advocacy Network, better known as SCAN. 50 years, they say we were heroes, the Freedom Riders. But I'm going to tell you, I now lead a new fight with new heroes. All of you are children. Thank you.
Dream one day. I have a dream that every valley shall be exalted. Every mountain, every hill will remain low. The rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed.
This is our hope.
This is the faith which I will return to the south. With this faith we shall be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith we shall be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to stand up and fight for freedom together, knowing one day we all this will be the day when all of God's children would sing with a new meaning. My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing, land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside, let freedom. I would like the congregation to say amen.
Hallelujah.
My original name was Michael Luther King. I later changed my name to Martin. I was born in Atlanta, Georgia in 1925. I was a preacher's son. My father was a Baptist minister, and his father before him. I graduated a segregated high school at the age of 15. After attending Morehouse College, I dedicated 3 years of my life to theological studies at Crozier Seminary. I met my wife Coretta while I was earning my graduate's degree at Boston University. Later, we settled down in Montgomery, Alabama, where I became 20th pastor of the Dexter Avenue Church. You see, when Rosa Parks was arrested for not relinquishing her seat to a white man on a bus, I organized a successful boycott of the Montgomery bus system that lasted 387 days in June 1956. The Supreme Court ruled that segregated buses were unconstitutional. This was a major victory in the heart of the civil rights movement because I had proved nonviolent methods can and will yield results. I was arrested upwards of 4 times. I was stabbed. My house was bombed. My family suffered through relentless personal attacks, but this did not stop me. I was willing to lay down my life in the cause of freedom. I wrote 5 books. I traveled over 1,000,000 miles. And at the age of 35, I became the youngest man to have ever received the Nobel Peace Prize. I earned the ear and respect of President John F. Kennedy. Because you see, I am American. I am deeply American because I have confidence and faith not only in God, but in the Constitution, in the principles of liberty and democracy for all. Because I've been to that mountaintop. And I don't mind like anybody. I want to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned with that here tonight, children. I just want to do God's work because he's chosen me to go to that mountaintop. And I looked over and I've seen the promised land. Now, I may not get there with you, but I want y'all all to know that we together as a people will get to that promised land. And I'm happy tonight. I'm not fearing anything or any man.
because my eyes have seen the glory in the coming of the Lord. Say amen, people. Say amen. Hallelujah.